Hey, it's time for TV Skywriter.
We are on. Welcome, folks. Greetings. Welcome to TV Skywriter. This is the local edition. I'm Patricia A. Murray, your host, and I have a very special guest here, Earl Ijames. He is a curator with the North Carolina Museum of History. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Patricia. Thank you for having me.
Real happy to have you because, I mean, we're sitting here talking. We're looking at my old family pictures and stuff. This man's really into history. And actually, let me ask you, there must be a reason that you're a curator. And why is it? First, tell us, what is a curator, for those of us who don't know, and then why are you a curator?
Well, a curator, in our case, at the North Carolina Museum of History, is one who collects and preserves and recommends artifacts for the state's collection for interpretation of our history and culture, plural, in North Carolina. So,
and talk a little louder.
Yeah, the curator is responsible for collecting and acquiring, identifying artifacts, primarily 3D, and as well as documents and photos for acquisition into the state's history collection so that we can help better explain and understand who we are as North Carolinians.
Okay. Yeah. And North Carolina being, I'm from Illinois, but I realize after having lived here a few years, North Carolina's history is quite long in comparison to some other states we might have visited throughout our lives because it's in the East.
Well, you're right. What's particular in understanding North Carolina, South Carolina, Carolina history is understanding the origins of it. And our society as we know it was literally chartered in 1663 as the Carolina Charter.
That's amazing.
It was a company that was established by 8 lords proprietors to King Charles in England.
Okay.
And King Charles named the place after his father, Carolus.
Oh, for real?
And this was his father was obviously king before he was. So this land was chartered in 1663, basically what is now the border of North Carolina and Virginia, spanning all the way across to the Pacific Ocean. So when you look at the current map of North of the United States of America, that same boundary line forms the boundary between Tennessee and Kentucky, and between Arkansas and Missouri, and going all the way out to the northern portions of Texas, Incorporated. Arizona and New Mexico, all the way. And at that time, when they chartered it, they didn't know it was a Grand Canyon there, but it originally would include was now Southern California.
So all of that was supposed to have been Carolina.
Correct.
And so did they lose? I mean, did people just chop away at it?
Well, you have to understand how the geography evolved during the colonial era.
Wow.
Because what originally started as the Carolina Charter in 1663 was split between North and South Carolina.
Right. I was wondering when that happened.
It's a series of explanations. It can be explained through the Tuscarora War of 1712 and 1713. Tuscarora Indians were the largest Indian tribe east of the Mississippi and in what's now North Carolina.
Not Cherokee.
No.
Oh, okay.
Not Cherokee. Tuscarora. And the English declared war on them in 1710.
Okay.
And had them removed to what is now upstate New York, Niagara Falls, in 1713. And so that was the first Indian removal process where Native Americans were removed from their native land to another space.
Okay.
So
that was the first time, because I think we've all heard of the Trail of Tears.
Right. And so the short story is that the colony couldn't defeat the Tuscarora. So the Tuscarora were very mighty Indian. They had 4 confederations, basically spanning what is now eastern North Carolina. From about Bertie County, which is in the northeastern part of North Carolina.
Okay.
And there's a Highway 17 that spans down the eastern part that basically dots the other 3 confederations, which would have been in present day Pitt County, where or Greene County, Pitt County area, where Snow Hill is, There's a site called Fort Naruka where a battle took place. And then not far from that, if you go continue south, is Fort Barnwell, which is another site in Tuscarora War, which is at the junction of Lenore County, Craven County, and Jones County, down in the far southeastern part of the state. And then if you continue south into what's now Duplin County, is where the southernmost Confederation was. They so, also had a...
So do any of them still... I mean, did they move them all to New York?
No, and that's the million-dollar question, because they were the largest and most powerful. Mm-hmm. The English could barely defeat them, much less remove them.
So I think they would have split them up, divide and conquer.
Well, what happened is a king in the north, and King Blunt, allied himself with the English. And as a result... Correct. The other three kings.
Okay. And that was a little short-sighted, but go ahead.
Well, it is, and it was then, but the long game was King Blunt probably facilitated the removal of the other three
confederations.
And so for his allegiance to the crown in England, he is awarded one of the first Indian reservations. Interestingly, it's
that was considered a prize, a reservation?
Well, you have to understand that if you're Indian and you saw the writing on the wall and you keep seeing ships and ships of Europeans coming, that at some point there's going to have to be some type of truce. So maybe King Blunt had a little foresight in that respect. But his reservation was located on the Roanoke River in Murphy County, and is near or very close to the present day site where recently was rediscovered that the lost colony may have gone to.
And so, for those of us who aren't from North Carolina, the lost colony, they were like the first group of white people, and they like disappeared.
First group of English settlers in the New World.
Didn't they put like some kind of little notice?
Well, what happens is
they disappeared somehow.
In 1587, Sir Walter Raleigh left a state capital, Raleigh, named for him, Sir Walter Raleigh, left a colony of about 100 English people on what is now the Outer Banks or Roanoke Island in particular.
Right. Okay.
So 3 years later, when he returned, they weren't there. There was just an inscription on a tree that says Croatan. So that mystery was never really solved. The Croatans were an Indian nation that was further south of the Tuscarora in what is now around the Wilmington area.
So what do you think? Do you think they were taken by the Croatan, or they moved in with the Croatan?
Well,
or
in my humble opinion, I think
murdered by the Croatan?
I don't think the Croatan would have murdered them, because the Croatan would have had to go through the Tuscarora to do that. Now, if anything, I think that the Croatan would have been more friendly than the Tuscarora, because the Tuscarora were known as a scalp you first and ask questions later type of Indian nation.
Tough guys.
So in my humble opinion, I think that the English colonists may have set out for the Croatan nation to evade the Tuscarora and never really made it, or may have made it, because there have been theories about abounding about that, because of the English influence and what people call now the Lumbee Indian of Robinson County. But in my humble opinion, I think a series of events may have culminated in the lost colony. Number one, if you are out on Roanoke Island for any 3 years span, you're going to come head to head with some hurricanes, you know. And
And so, every few years there's a massive hurricane, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, eastern North Carolina sticks out like a peninsula.
Eastern North Carolina
and Florida are number one targets for hurricanes.
Usually,
if they don't hit Florida, they go across the Gulf and hit Louisiana.
They're always flooding the roads
in eastern North Carolina. That's why you have those deep ditches on the sides of the roads in eastern North Carolina. But and if they don't hit and go across Florida, they come up the coast and hit eastern North Carolina. So in my humble opinion, they may have experienced at the very least a tropical storm, and maybe something along the lines of a magnitude Cat 5. We don't know. That is a possibility, certainly. most,
you know, with all the speculation I've heard, I haven't heard yet about the hurricanes. It's just natural.
Well,
to
it's
consider.
Natural, and that's one reason why the Indians didn't live on the Outer Banks, and that's the reason why it was uninhabited recently, until people invented air conditioners and things like that.
Okay.
No one lived out there. It was a barrier island that was made to absorb storms, basically.
I can see your love for history. Your job at the North Carolina Museum of History, that must be like a playground for you.
Well, it's fun. And I enjoy it. And someone once said, if you like what you're doing, you have a working day in your life. So, I do put in quite a bit of work, and I do enjoy it, though.
I can see you enjoy it.
Yeah. I think that hurricane may have been a plausible explanation. Mm-hmm. I think more plausible are the Tuscarora, who were known to get to make their braids and their Tuscarora nation. They would go out and scout neighboring tribes, or capture them, and bring them back.
So you're saying some of them still exist?
Well, the Tuscarora presently have a petition before the state of North Carolina to be officially recognized by the state of North Carolina.
Why wouldn't they be? Because I know the Lumbee, they're having a problem.
Well, the Lumbee.
Somebody said they've been mixed. So
well, that's exactly right.
To the point see, this too goes, diluted to be called Indians.
Well, see, this goes back to the migration patterns and the genealogy as was now North Carolina being settled.
Mm-hmm.
Was now Robeson County or the North of South Carolina was basically a swamp area, and no one really lived there.
Okay.
Many Indians started to flee there when their lands were being taken, say Tuscarora, the Croatan, the Waccamaw, the Chirwaw, the Catawba Indians. All these Indians, the PD Indians, lived on the edges of the great PD River Basin that forms the North and South Carolina border.
Okay.
And so, just like any other place, you're going to live on the high ground, but when you're forced to leave your home, they fled into swamps. And part of the reasoning because of that is that many Europeans wouldn't go in the swamp because of fear of yellow fever.
Okay, so they didn't chase them down.
They
just stayed there.
Leave them in there a lot of times. And so
could they really survive?
Well, obviously, they would go. These were hunting places. Native American, they knew the terrain, knew the land, so they.
Okay. Now I'm asking because I'm from Chicago. I haven't seen a swamp. I didn't know that was a place you could actually survive.
Oh, yeah, it is. And that's what we did for hundreds of years in the colonial and antebellum in the Carolinas. When we were seeking freedom, most people didn't go north. They went into the swamps. And eastern North Carolina is just dotted with swamps. And the low country, South Carolina, many people are familiar with that.
I need to see more of the state.
People
tell me these wonderful stories, and I'm like, I haven't seen that much.
Well,
I need to really make a serious plan to make a tour of the state I'm living in.
Well, we highly recommend it. We are the fifth largest tourism attraction among states.
Really?
Only California, New York, Florida, Hawaii are ahead of us. And of course, when you look at their tourists, they are different types of tourists. Most people who come to North Carolina, they come here for that historical experience, to live in an old bed and breakfast, or to go to one of the beaches, or go to a reenactment. Or
I think our beaches were called number one.
Oh, yeah. They're clean. They're actually clean. And not crowded. And there's lots of shoreline. And then when you go to the Outer Banks, you have an inside and outside.
Ooh, I can't wait to go to the Outer Banks. It's my dream.
Yeah, it's highly
my real dream is to see a lighthouse.
Well, you got to go.
I want to see a lot. I have not seen a lot.
Tours of lighthouses up and down the coast is really.
I can't. One of these days. Now, we're also here to talk about this right here. Can you see? A really cool new exhibit. And it's called Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, and the Birth of Funk. Yes, we're talking about music.
Yes.
So. And I know you know Howard Burchett, who seems to be the king of funk around here with the funk show on WNCU. So,
now, did you hear our show that we did with Sam Lathan?
I heard about. I couldn't listen, but I hope I can get a podcast or something.
You have to check it out. You can get it on. I'll
call Howard and ask Howard.
Well, and we have it lined up on our website at the Museum of History, ncmuseumofhistory.org. So you can go there and plug into it. We recorded that with Sam Lathan, who used to be a drummer for James Brown and the Famous Flames. And he lives down in Wilson County, North Carolina. Still performs 2-hour shows. He's 86 years old.
For real?
Yeah. He's very good. Highly
is he part of this exhibit?
He is.
Well,
he
tell me about the exhibit because I haven't seen it yet.
Okay, well, the exhibit, again, is called Hey America, Eastern North Carolina and the Birth of Funk.
Mm-hmm.
And what it is about are the musicians who James Brown turned to upgrade his image during the early 1960s.
Because he wasn't quite funky enough at that time.
Well, if people who can remember James Brown when he started in 1955, his famous Flames, it came straight out of a church group out of Barnwell, South Carolina, Augusta, Georgia, North Augusta, South Carolina.
Because James Brown is from Augusta, that's right.
He's from Augusta. Mm-hmm. He's born in Barnwell, South Carolina, which is over Savannah River.
I didn't know he's born.
He's a native South Carolina. And so he grew up hacking turpentine like many North Carolinians in Lonely Pine Forest. He was a Tar Heel, I guess you can say.
Literally.
He and Bowie and Les Bowie and some of the other folks there formed a band in 1955.
Said Les Bowie. That's not Lester, not the trumpet player. The jazz guy? Lester Bowie?
Bobby Bird, I'm sorry. Bobby Bird. Yeah,
okay,
Bobby Bird, I'm sorry. They left Augusta and formed the Flames in 1955.
All right.
That was kind of a rhythmic gospel group.
Yeah.
But it had a twist and a flair of a Little Richard with the performance and the showmanship of Daniel Brown.
Mm-hmm.
And so they performed this act for about the next 6-7 years.
All right.
Until 1962, when Daniel Brown wanted to get out of his contract. He wanted to really take advantage of this burgeoning demand for Black musicians that could perform in integrated venues.
Was that not happening at that time?
Well, in very few places.
Okay.
Very few places. Right. But if you remember.
So he sensed that he could make some money.
Right. And you remember now, he's a visionary, so the 64 Civil Rights Act hadn't come out. There's talk about this, about a march on Washington, about this Civil Rights Act. Remember, this is how Kennedy got elected on the Civil Rights platform. Large Black vote voted for President John Kennedy.
Mm-hmm.
So that was an anticipation of some form of civil rights, equality, and law.
Mm-hmm.
And so James Brown, being a businessman, very acute business person, wanted to take advantage of this. So before 1962, the Flames were pretty much a Little Richard lookalike type of band. James Brown would dance, do gyration, of course, he was a showman. But his lyrics, they were not that profound. And of course, the beat and the music was that 1950s type of bop almost, and that Little Richard. So James Brown transforms himself in 1963 first. There's the March on Washington. And remember the heights of the Civil Rights Movement. And so for people who can recall that time who were living there, there was a certain spirit decor of the Civil Rights Movement. And of course, after the March on Washington, it was really galvanized. Mm-hmm. And then President Kennedy was assassinated in November of 1963.
Mm-hmm.
And during this time frame, Brown said, well, you know, he can't basically do that low-level type of almost vaudeville.
Yeah.
Showmanship. He wanted to have more content to his lyrics, more of an impact.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew about this certain sound, this certain group of musicians who were already performing at this high level of professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
They were college educated. And it started with Nat Jones, a Kinston native who graduated magna cum laude from North Carolina Central here in Durham, music school in 1960.
All right.
He had his own show. He knew the performers. He knew who could do what throughout the state. And of course, Mr. Sam Lathan, in the interview that we did on the funk show, he says that as far back as 1948, now Mr. Lathan's born, Mrs. Sam's born 1929.
All right.
So he's already performing by this time. So he's saying they were performing funk. They were playing funk music.
They weren't calling it funk, right?
No, no. They weren't calling it funk, but they were performing that sound of music in Eastern North Carolina, in Wilson County, where he's from.
Okay.
In Lenoir County in Kinston, where Nat Jones from, and Pitt County in Greenville, down where ECU is, and all these areas down where you get good Eastern North Carolina barbecue.
So this is just a regional kind of thing.
It was kind of a regional thing, but these guys had created this sound, this musical sound that was not quite jazz, but it wasn't this doo-wop. Mm-hmm. It was a mix that was brought to a higher level when these guys showed up in a shirt and tie.
Okay.
And so what is Nat Jones? He went to Central, graduated, you know, Mac Cum
Laude. Yeah.
And so Nat Jones is sought after by James Brown to become his next band director. And band director meant that not only was he directing the band, but he was in charge of hiring the musicians.
Okay. So, now, did he go for it at first, or did he I mean, was James Brown a big enough name for this guy to say yes immediately?
Absolutely. Now, James Brown was a brand name in 1963. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was known. And, of course, he had done his famous 1962 at the Apollo and then the Pure Dynamite album. He recorded live at the Royal Theater in Baltimore, New York. So it was James Brown was hot.
Okay, so he
and
said
you could
yes.
call him almost a free agent. I mean, he knew, James Brown knew he was hot.
Mm-hmm.
But he also knew that he was locked into this contract dispute, and so he wanted to get out of this contract, and so his recording company said, well, if you sing on another song, then we're going to sue you. So James Brown, being the genius he was, he gets Nat Jones to write Grits and Soul in 1964.
Okay.
You got to see it. You'll see it in the exhibit.
Okay.
And in turn, Nat Jones hires Levi Raspberry, who is presently retired engineer from Greenville, North Carolina, Pitt County, who was only 17 at that time, musician.
Wow.
And then he hires, probably his most famous hire was Melvin Parker, who was attending North Carolina A&T at that time.
Okay. And, this is so funny to hear about these people being college educated.
Oh, yeah. These guys, in fact, Melvin Parker tells a really interesting story. He said when James Brown, he was playing in his band. He had his own band at the El Waco Club near North Carolina A&T in early 1964 when James Brown comes to his show after his James Brown performs, he comes to see Melvin Parker at the El Rocco Club. He says, man, that's a funky drummer. So it's like this. It's like the first time you hear this tone. So he offers him a job. So Melvin Parker calls his dad back in Kansas and says, you better graduate from college. So basically, he almost had to be in the band on the sneak tip while he graduated from A&T.
Isn't that interesting?
But in the meantime, the most probably a more familiar name is Maceo Parker.
Oh, yeah, Maceo.
Maceo Parker is Melvin Parker's brother, who also attended A&T at that time.
Okay.
And he happened to be on tour with his band when this happened. And so Melvin said, well, if you hire me, you got to get my brother too. You probably want to hear him, you know. Maceo was already known. Back in Kinston, Eastern North Carolina, for playing that funky saxophone. And he also played piano. A lot of people don't know. So these guys were all college-educated people. They, you know, back in the city, they wore shirt and ties to college and stuff. So they were very professional.
That was so weird.
And their look and their demeanor and their education. So this is the look and the level of professionalism that James Brown was seeking to elevate his level of professionalism so that he could take advantage of these newly opened venues in the 1960s that were going to be integrated.
Okay.
So
see where you're getting.
Part of our exhibit talks about how James Brown and this new sound funk encourages whites from all over to come to the newly integrated venues and pay top dollar to see a James Brown performance.
Interesting.
And what a lot of people don't know and understand that the people who wrote the music, Nat Jones, and the people who were playing in the background, Dick Knight is another person. Dick Knight was the former band director at Florida A&M University.
Okay.
Also lives down in Kinston. And
so when people go to this exhibit, do they hear this story?
Well, yes.
Do
they... This story is on the panels in the exhibit. We talk about, okay. And I've interviewed the musicians, and they give me very good anecdotes.
Mm-hmm.
Their artifacts on exhibit.
Do you have actual musical instruments?
Yeah, we have Melvin Parker's drums right in the middle. And then on one side is Maceo Parker's saxophone. Mm-hmm. On another side is Nat Jones's saxophone. Wow. And then behind Nat Jones is James mm-hmm. Brown's outfit and some shoes. We talk about the story, and also... Mm-hmm. It's interactive, so you can listen to Grits and Soul,
mm-hmm.
which, if I can reintroduce your audience to the first funky sound people ever heard, or groovy is what a lot of people, you know, it's all musical, which really catches people by surprise.
Yeah.
James Brown plays the piano on the album.
So you
and
were
he,
saying,
and he doesn't sing on the album because it would be a breach of his contract.
See, that's what I was going to get back to. So he was told if he sang another song,
right. He would be sued.
So he hired all these cats.
He hired Matt Jones. Matt Jones hires all these cats from Eastern North Carolina.
So he doesn't sing. So who sings?
There's no singing on the album. It's all musical.
And it still scores with the audience.
Oh, yeah. It's funky. And so once it happens, when Dick Knight, who was hired by Matt Jones, tells a very interesting story. He was a music teacher at Savannah School in Kinston back in 1964. And he says he gets a call at the principal's office from Matt Jones. Matt Jones says, hey, I got a job. You want to play for James Brown? He says, well, he says, yeah. He says, be at the Apollo Theater this Friday at 4 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
So Dick Knight gets excused, gets to New York, and gets to the Apollo.
He just picks up roles in New York?
Well, Matt Jones sent him the plane ticket.
Excuse me,
you know.
They had it going on.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I mean, these guys, I mean, when I say they already had their business going with James Brown, they weren't sitting around waiting. These guys were already touring. The Chitlin' Circuit is what we used to call it back then, right? Now, and you heard these guys, they were a lot of times old tobacco warehouses or places, you know, in town where on the other side of the track sometimes where the white audience would come, you know, on the sneak tip and come over to see them play. Dick Knight and another person in the group, well, actually Bill Myers, who stars the Monitors back in 1957. This group, a lot of these guys played with them.
I've heard of a group called the Monitors.
Yeah, the Monitors.
What song did they do?
Oh, they do a lot of songs. I can't name any off the top of my head.
The name's familiar. But go ahead.
But yeah, they also start. But these musicians all flow through and out of continuously. And they still play the Monitors, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like I said, these guys in their 70s and 80s now.
Are they part of the Carolina Beach music scene?
Well, the interesting story is Bill Myers would say the white folks would invite them to come to the beach and play the same music, but they would call it beach music.
Yeah, because I didn't hear about them until I moved here.
But the same music they would play back in Greenville or Kinston or Wilson, and they would call it race music or black music.
Yeah.
And so obviously when they went to play for an all-white audience down on the beach, they couldn't call it race music, so they just changed it to beach music.
Okay. Because I noticed a lot of those beach music musicians are Chicagoans, like Major Lance. And a lot of the groups that are popular in Carolina beach music, I don't know why. But a lot of them are Chicago guys. Jerry Butler.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's really interesting. But go ahead. I don't want to take away from what you're saying.
But yeah, at any rate, so Dick Knight tells a story that he gets to the Apollo and knocks on the back door. And a big bodyguard answers, who are you? He says, well, I'm here to see Matt Jones. So he goes to get Matt Jones. And, oh, hey, mate, come on in. So he goes in and goes straight to see James Brown. James Brown is in a chair getting his hair done.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, and he does a funny
thing. Back then, did he have the process?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And so he's literally getting his hair done.
Yeah.
And James Brown said, hey, man, how'd you battle on? You know? He said, oh, yeah, I do a little something. He says, go on over, let me see what you can do. Is what he says.
Wow.
So they were actually practicing.
That was
their
a
power.
Good.
So he said, so. Excuse me. So he goes over there and he says that they're practicing 2 and 3 deep.
Yeah.
Because James Brown had 2 or 3 deep musicians like that.
Wow.
And that as he's playing his horn, that the guy in front of him, you know, they were doing some steps and moves and they would dip their head and how they choreograph it. So the guy in front of him, a syringe fell out of his coat. And he said, now, James Brown didn't allow for any of that. And he said, remember now, he's trying to elevate his level of consciousness, so he couldn't have that. So he said, before he knew it, one of those bodyguards grabbed that guy in one hand and pushed him to the floor in the other hand. He said, that night he planned on the power.
Oh my goodness.
So Dick Knight.
How about pressure?
Yeah. Now Dick Knight will be playing at the museum in October. And I would highly recommend you. And you talk about Carolina Beach. If you get a chance to go down to Morehead City, Emerald Isle, those places down there. I think there's a place down there called Gregory's that he performs and he sells the place out.
I bet.
And Dick Knight does a famous rendition of Baby Baby Please with the cake.
Oh, look. Tell us about so James Brown, he elevated his game.
Right, right.
Upgraded his musicians.
So he releases Grits and Soul in 1964.
All right.
And as soon as this happened, Matt Jones comes out with this saying, Poppy's got a brand new bag.
Oh.
Meaning the whole music industry's been changed.
Right? That became a song.
Because in 1965 they recorded that. Mm. And 65, of course, James Brown's no longer under that contract requirement. And he can sing to this funky new sound that Matt Jones has created called Funk. And so after that, the rest is history, and that is the James Brown that we all know and love.
Okay.
The world's most famous entertainer.
Hardest
working showman and the godfather of funk and the godfather of soul and all that. Yeah, we talk about that in the exhibit, and we talk about how those origins of funk are, you know, people don't know. George Clinton just celebrated his birthday. He's from outside Charlotte.
Right.
Cabarrus County,
Would I be wrong in saying, didn't Bootsy, the bassist?
Well, Bootsy Collins from Cincinnati.
Yeah, but didn't he play?
They all played together. They all, because what happened, and as the funk music evolved, they get wildly popular in the mid-60s with the new sound.
Mm-hmm.
And so by the 1967 time frame, there's some fractures and some relationships. With James Brown wasn't known to be the most
diplomatic, kind.
Yes, I mean he's very demanding.
He's taskmaster.
And very possessive of every aspect of his brand.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So Maceo Parker tells another good story that was tired of being treated like that and basically didn't have to be treated like that, you know, remembering where he came from.
Mm-hmm.
So he sets out and wants to leave the band and take all the king's men.
I'm sure he didn't, right?
Well, he left and some of the folks did leave with him. Matt Jones, in particular, he started back on his own solo career. But he also still, whenever James Brown wanted something, Matt Jones, being that great guy he was, would answer a phone call and help him out.
That's cool.
So
now I do remember that there was a time. Oh, that's a good phrase, isn't it? When there'd be James Brown songs out, but then you would hear similar sounding songs by Bobby Bird and Lynn Collins and different people.
Oh yes.
So was he doing kind of like? Did you think Mr. George Clinton picked up on that?
Well, George Clinton,
because it was like little offshoots.
Well, see, George Clinton and joined into what they formed Parliament Funkadelic in 1968 as a result of this movement in 67. And that's when Parliament Funkadelic was formed, and then George Clinton gets Bootsy Collins on board, who's out of Cincinnati, Ohio.
So it was like they were doing the same thing James Brown was doing.
Basically, they were just basically
different groups, different names, different music labels.
Just like a good example today is you take the kind of genre of rap music, there's a certain sound to it, and now everybody's kind of biting off of it, for lack of a better word.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you could extrapolate that back 50 years, when James Brown creates, or Matt Jones, I should say, creates this funk sound, you get offshoots from it. And then now we have a whole genre of music called funk, you know, that really takes off in the 70s. This all comes out of, in large part, Eastern North Carolina, where you got these guys who were down in these tobacco warehouses. Bill Myers and Dick Knight tell a good story, you know, talking about the other side of the track, that when the white crowd would show up in these tobacco warehouses, the sheriff would come and drop a rope down the middle of the warehouse to keep white on one side and colored on the other side.
Oh, okay.
And they said that they would get to play and jamming and, you know,
playing music. Couldn't even play it again.
And the kids and the people would start dancing together and going on the rope, and they didn't know the whole crowd is integrated. Right?
Okay.
So it's affecting the Mets of the Civil Rights Act.
Interesting.
Unwittingly, really.
Yeah, yeah.
This is one thing that James Brown knew and understood and realized, that he could capitalize on that market.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it just makes sense if you could sell twice as many tickets.
Sure, right.
Right? So
I'm glad for this exhibit, because not being from North Carolina and growing up with the music, I just assumed I always knew he was from Augusta, Georgia.
Okay.
Also hometown of my granddad. So I just assumed that all that funk came from Augusta. And I'm really glad
that
this exhibit,
that genius came from Augusta.
Yeah, yes. But this exhibit is setting us straight as far as where the musicians and the sound came from.
Right, right.
I had no idea that North Carolina had anything to do with it.
Well,
it seems it almost has everything to do with it.
Well, you know, to some degree, it goes back to that Carolina Charter Ordinance. That basically, a lot of things that span west from North or South Carolina originate in North or South Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the mores and folkways,
mm-hmm.
the Southern way of life,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Know.
The Confederacy, if you take out, you know, if you look at the former Confederate states,
mm-hmm.
except for Virginia, they're all in the Carolina Charter. And so, you know, well, Florida, you could say Florida was really.
Of course, that wouldn't include Mississippi and Alabama.
Well, Mississippi and Alabama would be in the heart of what would later became, well, what was originally Carolina Charter. Mississippi, you know, was a lot of the, another history lesson, a lot of the homesteaders in Mississippi were people who fought with Andrew Jackson at New Orleans in the War of 1812.
Okay.
So when the 1812 war was finished in 1815, they returned back to North Carolina. They began prospecting the Creek and the Choctaw lands.
Okay.
So they put in claims and for homestead, for farms and have and by 1817, Mississippi is chartered as a state in the Union within the Carolina Charter.
Remember? Okay, now this Carolina Charter, what's the northern tip of that?
It's the Virginia-North Carolina border. The Virginia-North Carolina border, the Tennessee.
Would that include going across southern Illinois and Indiana? Because they said the Klan actually started in southern Illinois and Indiana.
It wouldn't. That's a different kind of Klan. That's a different, that's what we call the second Klan in the what you see out in Muncie, Indiana, in that area is from the 1920s and part of the 20th century.
That's a different Ku Klux Klan.
It's not a different Ku Klux Klan. It's a it's what we historians call the second Klan. In other words, the Klan originates. I know we're skipping all over.
I know this is fine for me. I hope the audience doesn't mind.
The Klan originates after the Civil War in Tennessee starts, and then in North Carolina, 1870s Reconstruction era politics. The Klan emerges and literally espouses white supremacy for the platform and the Democratic Party.
Okay.
And so the Klan is used to enforce that during this time.
Okay.
Frame.
Okay.
You know, some would argue that when the federal troops left the South in 1877 after the compromise of 1876, that the Klan goes away, but it really doesn't. It really is embodied in the coup d'etat in Wilmington in 1898.
Oh, you thought that,
well,
it was only
first coup d'etat, and only coup d'etat in American history. And it was a literal takeover of government with bloodshed and loss of property. And let's just call it what it was. It was not a random riot. It was not a random. It was pre-calculated with a paramilitary wing. With a political element in the Democratic Party led by the Democratic chair, North Carolina Fernie Poe Simmons. And it was a media blast led by the Raleigh News and Observer and Josephus Daniels, who purchased that paper in 1896.
Whoa.
So this was an orchestrated act to take over the largest city in North and South Carolina that was the hub of enterprise that just happened to be 70% of a very long-standing, persistent black populace.
Interesting.
And they were very highly skilled. I mean, we're talking lawyers, doctors, architects, cotton factors, turpentine factors.
I want you to come back and just talk about that.
Because
that's really a fascinating story.
It is. But that is literally, in short, what sets up Jim Crow and segregation throughout the South. And that's what starts it. The claim that you refer to is emerges to enforce Jim Crow.
Okay.
After 1900, and the interesting thing is that some of the more virulent Second Klan factions are in the Midwest.
Yeah.
When you see that famous 1924 march in Washington, D.C., the Klan march, most of those are Midwesterners from Indiana, Illinois, and not Southerners. There's a misconception to that. Mm-hmm. And of course, the third Klan emerges during the contemporary civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s.
You don't hear about this one.
Yeah, this is the Klan that Martin Luther King referred to when he comes to North Carolina. He says, you know, North Carolina is the most progressive Southern state with the largest Klan population. Which kind of
interesting. Weird.
Yeah, but he gives that information in 1965 at NC State when he gives a speech. But literally, the Klan in the 1950s and 60s is what most people identify because they were the ones standing in front of the schools integration and desegregation. And this is also where we get the current perceptions about the Confederate flag.
Because this is
third Klan that used the Confederate battle flag to espouse white supremacy in particular and segregation.
Mm-hmm.
And so in most Black Southerners' mind in particular, that is what the Confederate flag stands for. And
that,
it doesn't refer to any of its original creation during the Civil War. So, but those are the three clans, and what you are referring to is the second Klan that is largely in the Midwest.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's one thing a lot of people don't know and understand. Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to return to this, Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, birth of fun.
If I can just give a plug for an online civil rights exhibit that we have,
www.nccivilrights.org.
nccivilrights.org. Okay. You can get more information on that website, and it's broken down into three segments. It begins in 1830 with the Indian Removal Act, and it ends in the 1980s. And the title of the website is called A Change Is Gonna Come, Black, Indian, and White Voices for Racial Equality.
Wow.
And it's an interactive site. There's audio, video, artifacts, documents, photos, interviews. I would encourage your listeners to check it out, and you can get a good and better understanding of these factions of the Klan.
They must really love you at the North Carolina Museum of History. I mean, you're like a walking encyclopedia. I mean, you just know so much.
Well, thank you.
I mean, I guess you have to,
but
it's nice that you do.
Well, you do because we get telephone calls, emails. Now we have social media, Twitter, Facebook, requests of all types and imaginable history-related content.
And you have to be able to help.
You have to be on your P's and Q's and know, or at least be able to refer people to the proper authority. So we at the Museum of History like to think of ourselves as the authority on history. And and so I'm one of a handful of curators there. And we not only service North Carolina, but we service national and international. We had over 400,000 visitors to the North Carolina Museum of History.
Wow.
And we're one of the largest attractions in the state. And I referred, you know, earlier in our conversation that our state's the fifth most visited state in the
Union.
And most of that is historical and cultural tourism.
Nice.
We have, like I said,
we need to take more advantage of that, I think.
Absolutely. People from all over the world come to our museum and they marvel that it's free. It's a free museum.
They marvel.
That is free. Yeah, because most museums you have to pay admittance or pay to go to programs.
Yeah, I heard that the museum in Washington, D.C., I wanted to visit. I didn't have time to visit. I just walked around the outside of it. I didn't even realize until I, you know, returned back home here to Durham that people have criticized the museum for their high admission fee. It's like $30 or something.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, see, that's one thing.
And they say that's pretty par for the course for a lot of
museums. And to a large degree, it makes it out of reach for certain demographics.
Yeah. So why is or how is it that the North Carolina Museum of History is free?
Well, quite frankly, our director, Ken Howell, has done a great job of keeping us in the black as far as our programming and helping suggest and advise the types of exhibits and programs. Mm-hmm. And we have a whole team of folks at the museum who collaborate. But our museum has always been run on a tight ship. Mm-hmm. And I've been a curator for the last 8 years at the museum. Okay. And for 18 years before that, I was an archivist at the State Archives.
Wow.
So we're in the same Department of Cultural Resources.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been in the Department of Cultural Resources for 25 years now, and we've always been very efficient with our tax dollars. Even when the times were good in the 1990s, I know we were very...
You didn't get extravagant even then.
We didn't get extravagant. So when we had to pare down, it wasn't a hard thing to do during the recession.
Okay.
I'm not going to say it wasn't hard, but we at least had some experience doing it.
So this very special event that happens this Saturday, the 15th, there is a fee.
Can
you tell us what will happen on this coming Saturday?
There's a nominal fee. We have a master class in performance by Mr. Tyrone Jefferson out of Charlotte, North Carolina, who was also a band director for James Brown.
Wow. What's the one instrument does he play?
I think he plays a multitude of instruments. I think he's going to be given a class on Saturday, a master class at 4:30. And here,
so, wait a minute. So is he going to teach? Because funk is very nuanced. I always wondered, can it really be taught?
Well, according to Sam Lakin, you got to have the ear for it. You got to have the rhythm for it.
Yeah.
But if you are willing to learn, I think it can be acquired.
And
so I would encourage anyone who loves music and especially funk music, you know, get your guitar or get your instrument and
so you're asking people to actually bring their instrument.
Well,
that would be awesome.
Well, if they, you know, I think it's going to be necessary if they're going to learn to play whatever instrument that they bring, what instrument they play normally.
I can't imagine being able to notate the notes in such a way. Yeah, you have to be there and feel it and play it.
Exactly, yeah. So
this is going to be a master class this Saturday. What time?
4:30.
Okay.
I would say be at the museum, you know, by 3:30. It's $5, which is a nominal fee. And not only is that a nominal fee, but after the master class, Tyrone Jefferson and his band, The Sign of the Times, will be given a performance at 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
At 6 o'clock here in the Daniels Auditorium at the museum. So
that's awesome.
For $5, you can get out of the heat, come to air conditioning, get a master class from Tyrone Jefferson and Funk, and you can get a live performance
nice.
Of Tyrone Jefferson.
For $5, that's not bad.
You can't beat it. Not with a 10-foot stick.
So where is the North Carolina Museum of History?
North Carolina Museum of History, our physical address is 5 East Edenton Street, downtown Raleigh, directly across from our historic state capitol, right there on Edenton Street.
Now, I've only been to this museum maybe twice, and I can't remember the parking situation. What is the parking situation?
On Saturday, you can park anywhere. There's no parking fees. There's no parking tickets given out on Saturdays downtown. Mm-hmm. So first come, first serve.
Nice.
And that's the reason why I say get there early, because downtown Raleigh is really happening on Saturdays and the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
And folks start coming in. Our museum opens at 9 o'clock.
Okay. Now, if I'm not mistaken, and correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't the Museum of History part of, there are other museums surrounding it?
Yes, I think that's. There's the State Capitol Mall that extends.
Yeah. I've been there. It's been a few years.
Well, you're right. Yeah. Right there on Edenton Street, where the front door of the museum is in State Capitol, there's a mall that extends down between our museum, the Museum, the North Carolina Museum of History, and the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences is on the opposite side of the mall.
Okay, because I saw some other museums.
Right. And then as you come down, the mall ends at the Legislative Building.
Okay.
So we're right there, literally in the heart of downtown Raleigh, in the state government complex.
Right.
And
is it possible to hit the other museums the same
day? Absolutely. Highly, that's what people do. That's part of this tourism industry that we talk about. Okay. People come, they'll come to our museum, they'll go to the state capitol. If you've never visited that. Let me explain this to you. Our state capitol was constructed by enslaved and free people of color. I have found records that indicate they were actually paid for their highly skilled labor.
Oh boy. The contractors or the workers themselves?
Both.
Okay.
Both. Now, here's the engineering, and we're talking, I like to educate people about slavery. These were so-called enslaved people who were stonemasons and carpenters and architects who built. When you go and see that capitol, there are these giant 4x8 granite blocks that are stacked one on top of the other. And you have to ask yourself, how in the world do they get perfectly stacked one on top of the other and perfectly hewn when there were no bobcats or backhoes or steam shovels to lift those blocks perfectly one on top of the other?
So how did they do it? Do you know?
Rope and tackle. And by eye. And with manpower and skilled manpower, because it's perfectly hewn. There's no rough look to it. I mean, it's an architectural marvel, Greek revival.
Wow, I have to check that out.
But
is that part of it? Is that explained to you as part of the tour, or are you just telling us?
Well, there are docents there who will explain that to you as part of the tour to state capitol. But you need to go in the summer, particularly in August when it's 9,500 degree heat index. Now, they have air conditioners in the place now. But if you can imagine going back there in 1840 when the building opened up in August, it was perfectly constructed so the dome draws air up and it creates an air conditioning effect. And these were so-called enslaved people who built this.
They supposedly didn't know anything.
Right. But they were paid for their labor. And
so you say that again. It is designed so that the air is...
perfectly comes up like a flute through... all four doors. They're east, west, north, and south door corridors.
Okay.
That before those glass doors were put there, they were basically drafts. So that whatever direction the wind is blowing, it will pull a breeze into the capital and cool it off and raise the heat, force it up out of the dome.
Interesting. See, I obviously need to go.
Absolutely.
Check this out.
Yeah. So the state capitol is an architectural marvel. I mean, how many people have an 1840 state capitol? And still, you know. Then there is right across Eaton Street is our Museum of History, and then the Museum of Natural Sciences, and then at the end of the mall, the State Legislative Building, where if you come during this month, actually, you'll get to see the legislature in session working. People make a tour, basically it was a rite of passage for school children. I, as a fourth grader growing up in Winston-Salem back in the 1970s, still have photographs of my tour to Raleigh.
It was a big deal.
Oh, it's a big deal. And so stay calm. And also tourists from all over the world come and experience it.
Well, I need to do my part.
Yeah,
I
highly recommend it. Yeah.
I need to do my part.
But when you come to the museum, Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, and the Birth of Funk, is a lobby case exhibit that's in the main lobby of the Museum of History. And also we have the Story of North Carolina exhibit, which is an award-winning best exhibit from 2012.
Okay.
We have the Story of North Carolina, the film industry. The 100-year
I was just writing about that for the Durham Skywriter.
Okay.
3,000 TV films, shows and movies have been filmed in North Carolina.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if we're still number three. I think the governor kind of put the kibosh on.
Well, I don't think it's the governor. I think the governor supports it. It might be some folks in the legislature may not necessarily support
it. But I don't know if we're still number three behind Hollywood and New York.
Well, Georgia is making a big push. You know, there's a big film industry burgeoning in Savannah and Atlanta.
I shouldn't be surprised. I mean, Atlanta's huge.
And so Georgia, and then there's also Universal Studios in Florida. But now we have Wilmington, which has been really coming on strong as a destination for filming. But when you go to the film starring North Carolina film exhibit, one of the artifacts in the exhibit is from my collection. I actually have two photographs from The Color Purple.
Was that filmed here?
It was filmed in Anson County.
Okay.
30 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And though there are two photographs that show a young Oprah Winfrey, a young Newkirk, the associate producer, and there's Steven Spielberg in the photograph, and Whoopi Goldberg.
Okay.
And you remember Shug Avery, who played in the film?
I'm not a good movie person. Well, I didn't see it.
Danny Glover, his character,
just, I know that is. Yeah.
He just fell literally over Shug Avery, who's like a blues singer.
Okay, okay.
Well,
let me ask you this. The first, I think it was the first African-American film director, Oscar
Michaud. Yes.
Did he do any movie, make any movies here in North Carolina?
I'm not sure about that, but
I don't even know where he made his movie.
Well, he's out of Chicago. Oscar Michaud can be seen in our online civil rights exhibit, nccivilrights.org, because he made a film called Within Our Gates in 1919. And it's a reply to Birth of a Nation. And Birth of a Nation.
I have that in my collection. I do have the CD.
Okay.
DVD. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, you can see clips on that website from 1919, Oscar Michaud. And you can also see about a 7-minute, 10-minute clip of Birth of a Nation.
Okay.
Which, interestingly, is alludes to Durham. And
really?
And the Camerons in Birth of a Nation allude to the Camerons, Ben Cameron, and Stagville Plantation. Yes.
Okay.
Well, there's an allusion to that in Birth of a Nation as a Piedmont plantation.
Oh,
and this film is 1915. Mm. That's based on an original novel by a North Carolinian named Thomas Dixon.
Oh.
It's called The Klansman. The book was called The Klansman.
Okay.
And that book is also on our online civil rights exhibit. But Thomas Dixon was one of these Democratic legislators from the 1880s out of Gaston County, west of Charlotte, that espoused that white supremacy platform that the Klan reinforced during Reconstruction. But he produced novels like A Leopard Spot or The Klansman that were meant to espouse white supremacy. And so the largest film that's produced in America in 1915, Birth of a Nation, is based on The Klansman. And is based in North Carolina.
Wow.
And so
you have to come back and tell us some more of this stuff. Yeah,
so you'll be able to see the original book, The Klansman, on that online civil rights exhibit, and you'll be able to see a clip of Birth of a Nation and Oscar Michaud's Within Our Gates.
Okay.
Yeah, they're very good. Highly educational.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, this $5 fee for the special programming on Saturday, that's only for that one day, right? So, in other words, when you come to see this Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, Birth of Funk exhibit, the $5 fee does not apply.
It's just for
Saturday.
There's no charge for that. Starring North Carolina, there's a $5 admission fee for that.
Okay.
That's kind of our large featured exhibit up in the
that's until what, September 7th?
September 7th,
like that.
That's right. And it's in our decorative arts gallery, a very large exhibit.
But for the most part, everything else is free.
Everything else is free, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, it was inspired largely. Matt Jones passed away last year, January 2014.
Mm-hmm.
And no one knew who he was. And it was a travesty. I mean, it's tragic because here is the man who brought the sound of funk to the world, and he died in Duplin County down in Eastern North Carolina. And
so he never became really super famous.
Well, people who are in the music industry know who he is, and people, like I say, down east in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, of course, knew who he is and was. But unfortunately, James Brown's icon just completely overshadowed everything else. Of course, again, we talked about the personality of James Brown. He didn't allow for any other room for it. And so this is part of
the reason. He wanted to be upstage, in other words.
Exactly. And this is in large part why Matt Jones left the band.
Do you think, so he died last year?
In 2014, yes.
So do you think that by now he has a sizable memorial headstone or anything?
Well, his brother, I've been talking to his brother, Edwin Jones, and his brother has just that in the plan. He's planning to produce a large headstone. He's buried down in Kinston, and I think he wants to draw attention to who his brother was as he was a genius of a musician.
Yeah. I mean,
he really was. He went to college to the famous music school here at Central, and the jazz school, and took a strain of that music and created funk.
That's amazing.
And he has the credentials, having graduated magna cum laude, to back up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so he is already doing his thing in 1960, 61, 62. But again, that sound, as Sam Lathan alluded to in the funk show, was as early as the 1940s.
That is amazing.
So this is what is being produced in our tipping circuit in segregated Eastern North Carolina and South Carolina and Georgia and places like that. And James Brown knew this, and people in the know knew who was hot. It's kind of like the thing. People know who the latest, hottest artists are.
Yeah.
And so they want to collaborate with the Nicki Minaj's or the Drakes and stuff like this. You know, so people know who Matt Jones was in 1961, 62.
So he's hopefully prominent in your
absolutely.
Exhibit.
Yes, he is. He's very prominently featured. As well as the other musicians, we really wanted to highlight, and that's why we don't mention James Brown that much, because James Brown, of course, everyone knows him.
He's the front man.
His role.
Yeah.
But when they learn about these other musicians, hopefully they'll understand and appreciate them more, and also support it, support these musicians, because these musicians,
they're still working.
They still work.
Yeah.
They still work. And I went to see Sam Lathan play down in Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
That guy's bad. He plays a mean drum.
Yeah.
And a 2-hour show. And
Dick Knight. He said he's 86.
Yeah. And Dick Knight.
I want to see him.
Dick Knight and Bill Myers will be at the museum in October. Highly, highly recommended. Those guys are bad. Just like bad boy. They are out of sight. Super dope dynamite.
Whoa.
Those guys are really, they will leave you in awe.
Wow.
And you will not even think about the fact these guys are 70-something, 80-something.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're just that
and
good.
And still funky.
That's right.
Okay, now.
Yep.
Man, we could talk for hours, but I guess we should probably go. But I want you to come back because since do you get to choose what you curate? Or are you assigned your exhibits?
We're assigned by our museum planning committee. Plans, museum, exhibits, and programs years in advance. And I brought a program calendar here for July and August. You can share it with your audience. But the programs and exhibits reflect commemorations in large part. But at the same time, this particular exhibit was something that I brought to the operation committee.
This is personal with you.
Well, I don't want to say it's so much personal because I grew up in West Salem, grew up listening to James Brown. Everybody knew and loved. I've seen James Brown. I mean, you never forget that. But then when you learn the nuances of the history, you really appreciate it. But then, like I say, I wanted really to honor these musicians because a lot of people don't know many of them other than James Brown. Some people know Maceo Parker. You know?
Sure. And that might be the biggest name
other than James Brown. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but there was a host of these other cats who were all equally good in their own right. And they deserve some recognition and honor. And like I said, these guys still perform.
Okay.
So,
who are these people in the picture? I'm going to show the audience.
That's Tyrone Jefferson and the Sign of the Times band that will be performing at the Museum of History, North Carolina Museum of History, this Saturday, August 15th, 4 o'clock, the master class. Actually, be there at 3 o'clock for the master class, and the actual concert is at 6 o'clock.
Okay. So technically speaking, the master class starts at 4:30, but you want them to get in there.
Yeah, because you know he's going to start. It's going to be over before you know it. And
plus, you want to, even if you're bringing a musical instrument, you want to be able to walk around and see the exhibit. Because by the time it gets all crowded, you might not be able to see it.
Yeah, and by the time you walk from your car to the museum, you want to sit down for a minute and get yourself together, and then be able to take full advantage of the class.
This is great. Yeah. So, can you tell us what the website is for the museum? Because I'm sure that people want to plan their visit.
www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. There's a web page for exhibits, and you can click on to the Hey America, Eastern North Carolina, and the Birth of Funk exhibit. And I also mentioned to you our online civil rights exhibit called A Change Is Gonna Come, Black, Indian, and White Voices for Racial Equality, which begins in 1830, which is civil rights that we talk about the origins of civil rights in our country. So that website is nccivilrights.org. And I'd encourage you to take advantage of that and refer it to your friends and family to good education, too.
Earl Ijames, thank you so much for being on the show.
Right.
Talking to people like you makes me realize that history really is fun. A lot of times when you try to tell kids that history is interesting, they're like, it has nothing to do with me, I'm not really interested. When they talk to people like you, they realize it all has to do with us, you, them.
Our present
it's really fun and interesting. It's not always fun.
Well,
it's always interesting.
I was recently doing an interview with Barry Saunders on the Raleigh News and Observer, mm-hmm. and one way I explained history is I likened it to peeling an onion. You know, you got to get to the core,
mm-hmm.
but while you're peeling it back, it might make you cry.
Make you tear up a bit.
Yeah, but you're going to get to that core and get to the truth. And so I would encourage your listeners, one way that we take history out of the abstract,
mm-hmm.
see, because our present day paradigm, our present reality is mm-hmm. a direct result of history.
Okay.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And one way that I encourage people to better understand and appreciate history is mm-hmm. just to do its simple genealogy chart, like what you've done,
mm-hmm.
I've done, we both understand the importance of,
and it takes curiosity about the family,
right, and of understanding who our ancestors, where we come from, and also honor them, but at the mm-hmm. same time it allows you to be able to have some foresight,
mm-hmm.
And also have that depth and perspective and mm-hmm. understanding
mm-hmm.
the past, you know, because it helped me tremendously in understanding a lot in my family,
mm-hmm.
that if I look at it from a contemporary eye,
mm-hmm.
it would just not make a lot of sense a lot of times. A good story is I have recently discovered that my grandfather, my mother's father,
mm-hmm.
Left me a relic that mm-hmm. was handed down from his grandfather.
Oh my God.
And it turns out my grandmother, who now lives out in Texas, he moved out of Winston-Salem
mm-hmm.
last year mm-hmm. out to San Antonio, Texas. So on the way out there, I drove out there, and she says, well, baby, I got something for you that belonged to your granddad. We'll find out, get it when I get out there. When I got out there, it turns out that it was a Civil War sword. And I said,
from the Civil War?
Yeah. And I said, well, Grandma, do you know what this is? She said, that's from your granddaddy's sword stuff. I said, this is a Civil War sword. You know anything about it? She says, no, but call your Uncle Bill. My granddad's youngest brother, still living. And he lives up in Davie County outside of Winston-Salem, still on his farm. And when I called him, he says, oh, yeah, he says, that sword belonged to my dad. He got it from his dad. And he calls my granddad.
God.
He says, your granddad got it because he's the oldest boy. But our granddad, John Wharton, was in the Confederate cavalry.
Wow.
He was and he earned his freedom in the Confederate Army before the Emancipation Proclamation.
Wow.
And this is a large part and reason why the Emancipation Proclamation was passed, because there were Southerners who were doing the same thing that Southerners and Northerners did
mm-hmm.
when the Rebel Army of 1776 seceded from Great Britain.
Okay.
Is that they freed slaves to fight in that army.
Who fought with them. They rewarded them with their freedom.
Right, right. And the same reaction
mm-hmm.
that President Lincoln had and the Federals had when they came down here and saw the mm-hmm. Confederates were doing that, well, General Lord Cornwallis mm-hmm. had the same reaction when he saw people like Francis Marion and General Greene and this crowd. Mm-hmm. My ancestor, Michelle Ijames, came from the West Indies to fight in the in the American Revolution.
Wow.
And so these folks were all also recruited by the most powerful army in the world at that time, Lord mm-hmm. Cornwallis and the British.
Okay.
So the same exact scenario unfolds mm-hmm. in the Rebel Army of 1861.
Wow.
When it was illegal for black people of color to be in the United States Army.
Mm-hmm.
When the Southern Army said that they would use you in any capacity that would deem necessary to effect victory.
Mm-hmm.
And that directly translates into what Frederick Douglass said in 1862, at the present moment, there were many colored men mm-hmm. in the Confederate Army mm-hmm. doing duty not only as cooks and laborers and servants, mm-hmm. but as real soldiers with bullets in their pockets and muskets on their shoulders and mm-hmm. ready to shoot down and do all that soldiers do to destroy the federal government.
Wow.
So.
And with that,
yes.
you have the perfect job and they have the perfect person working for them, being the North Carolina Museum of History. This is fantastic talking with you.
Well, thanks. Wow. It's been great talking with you too, Patricia. Yes.
And if you, viewers, if you know someone who wants to enhance their funk skills, or if they're just huge fans, check out this incredible masterclass that's going to be held at the North Carolina Museum of History on Saturday.
August 15th.
Right, August 15th, 2015. So technically it starts at 4:30, but Mr. Ijames said obviously you need to get there early. There's, I think a lot of people are going to show up. Well, there's going to be a lot of guitars and basses up in there.
We hope so. We hope.
And saxophones and what? Who knows what else?
We hope it's a funky good time.
Funky good time.
Yes.
And with that, I will bid you adieu. Now, if you would like to be on TV Skywriter, there's a Sunday edition. This is our local edition. It doesn't matter. I mean, both shows actually end up on YouTube. The only difference is that my weekday shows I set aside for local folks, local being Durham, Raleigh, Chapel Hill, Hillsboro, Cabo, you get the drift. So if you want to be on the show, just write to me at durhamskywriter@gmail.com. And if you're local or you're just interested in Durham, North Carolina, be sure to read the Durham Skywriter. That's durhamskywriter.com. You can subscribe to this channel, Patricia A. Murray. I use my real name because I do, with YouTube, talk to people across the country that might not have any ties to Durham. And with that, adieu. Ciao for now. I'll see you later.
Adieu, au revoir.
All these different languages. Ciao.